The coordinator of the Presidential Task Force on COVID-19, Dr. Sani Aliyu, says the August 29th resumption of international flights as announced by the PTF COVID-19 briefing is not sacrosanct. Aliyu, who made a clarification at the PTF on COVID-19 briefing on Monday in Abuja, explained that the date would be for consideration of resumption of flights. According to him, August 29th is not sacrosanct, but if aviation authorities meet the criteria for resumption on the 29th, they will be given the green light to resume. Earlier, the Minister of Aviation, Hadi Sirika, said that international flights which were suspended by the nation's aviation authorities in the country as a result of the outbreak of the COVID-19 pandemic globally would resume on the 29th of August 2020. Sirika said Nigeria's international airports had reached advanced stages of preparedness for the resumption of international flight operations. And joining us now is Wole Shadari, aviation expert and editor at Daily Telegraph, to help us analyze the resumption of international flights in Nigeria. Thank you so much for joining us, Wole.
Thank you very much. Thank you, and thank you for having me.
It's been a kind of mixed bag out there on this announcement. While it's good news for those who had been stranded, many Nigerians especially the thought of the index case of COVID-19 from Italy, got them worried. What exactly, you know, are your feelings at the moment?
Like you rightly said, it came with a mixed bag, a mixed feeling that we're going to resume international operations, and also comes with the fact that have we done enough for international flight to resume? The answer depends on what the government is doing. The government is working assiduously to ensure that all the protocols from World Health Organization, from International Civil Aviation Organization, ICAO, are met. 29th is still a few days time, but like I read this morning, that 29th is not sacrosanct, according to the consultant to COVID-19 pandemic. Is not sacrosanct. What they actually said is that they will look at the protocols we have put in place. They will look at it to see if we are met with the guidelines before we can begin to talk of reopening the airspace. 29 is not actually the day international flights, airlines will resume operation into Nigeria or out of Nigeria. It is just a guideline to see if we will meet up with it. If we meet up with that, who knows, it may happen on the 29th, but 29 is just a few days from now, and I doubt if we have really done enough to begin to say we want to open the airspace.
What would you say government
is considering that if you look at it, a lot of things are happening. The evacuation flights are very, very expensive to come about by individuals, and a lot of families are stranded all over the world. Not only Nigerians, but other nationals. People are traveling, but it shows you that we have a lot of foreigners in this country with the type of evacuation flight that has taken place since April this year.
Yeah.
So it really comes with some are happy because they want to return home and be able to afford scheduled flight operation rather than the evacuation flight, which are about 2-3 times higher than the normal fare.
Right. Mr. Shadari, I want you to speak on what you feel, in what ways do you feel we may not be able to meet up before the 29th? You know, in what ways do you think we may be lagging behind with getting ready for international flights to kick off?
Yes, if you look at the airport, FAN has done a lot of work, but I doubt, because it's not only FAN, we also need to look at the health implication of what we're going to do, because international operation is quite different from domestic flight operation. It comes with its challenges. The challenges are even more than domestic flight operations that we have started since July 8th. Basic things need to be put in place, security need to be put in place, and you know, for over close to 6 months now, the security architecture has reduced at the airport because of the scaling down of flights, which means that only emergency flights are allowed. But you can imagine 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 airlines coming in at the same time or almost at the same time. You need to put certain things in place to ensure, like I said earlier, in terms of health equipment, medical equipment, in terms of personnel, in terms of knowing when to, how long it takes to process one passenger and what we need to do. And if you also look at our airport, you find out that we don't have enough infrastructure at that airport even before COVID-19. So I wonder how government is going to provide all these facilities before now. But be that as it may, international flights will not be closed forever. We just have to open it at a point. So I just hope, or we just hope, that enough has have been done to ensure that we can actually commence international flight operations.
All right. I also want to know, do you feel, as we're having this conversation about the 29th, you know, whether we return or not, do you think Nigeria should bar flights from, you know, certain countries with high cases?
No, because you also look at these things are interwoven. If I open my airspace and the majority of the countries have not opened their own airspace, it becomes almost the same thing, because I don't know where people will decide to fly to. You can't just pick an aircraft and say you want to fly to point B if you are not permitted to land or take off from that airport. It becomes a national issue, a diplomatic issue rather, between countries. So I think if we open our airspace, we can only fly, we can only operate to countries that have also opened their airspace. It's like a reciprocal thing. You know, you go to my own country, I come to your own country. But if I haven't opened my airspace, there's no way you can fly apart from getting permission to do emergency or humanitarian flights. So if you also look at, around Africa, we have about 54 countries in Africa, if I'm right. I think only 12 or 13 countries have opened their airspace to international air travel. South Africa hasn't done that. And many other strong economies in Africa have not done that. So it is not going to be a kind of celebration, because what we are looking at that we should be able to tackle this COVID-19 pandemic and the whole world, not only Nigeria. If we're able to do that, I guess we may begin to see return to what we had pre-COVID-19.
Yeah. All right.
So be that as it may, they need to work hard. They need to make sure that all those guidelines by ICAO, International Civil Aviation Organization, and more importantly, by the World Health Organization, to ensure that we do not go back to what we had before, because we have seen countries that relaxed restriction only for them to go back and say, no, we are going to do total close down again. We
all
just
right.
hope
I
that
also,
we don't
I also
return
wanna...
to that position
hopefully
that
we don't
find ourselves.
All right, Mr. Shadari, I also want to talk about the economic part of this, because I believe that it's one of the fears of passengers. The economic loss that the shutting down of the airspace over the last few months, you know, has been, you know, tremendous. I hope the passengers won't be made to bear the brunt, you know, of this economic loss, and of course through their airfares.
Yes, because they will somehow, but again, you cannot punch the passengers beyond what they can take. When it gets too expensive, nobody is going to fly you, and you're going to continue the downward spiral because nobody wants to fly. Look at domestic airline operations, for instance. When they were going to lift restrictions on domestic airport air travel, people thought that airfare would be so expensive that it would be very difficult to even come by. But the reality dawned on everybody, even the airlines, that they cannot even go beyond what they planned, because nobody will fly. People are even managing to fly to travel by air this day. The airlines are running at a huge loss. I do not know how they are even going to, most of them are going to survive before January 2021. The situation looks so difficult, it looks so dire. So they are just hoping that with international air flight restriction on the international flight lifted, it will help boost their bottom line marginally. You know, because when people come in through Nigeria and they want to go to places like Enugu or Nwere, they have to join domestic airlines. So it will boost their revenue by less than even 1%. So that 1% is even huge for them, to tell you how bad the situation has degenerated for airlines in Nigeria. They have burned their cash, they have burned all their reserves, and the palliative is not coming in from government, I don't think they are even going to get it this month or next month. And if they are not going to get it this month or next month, and we are gradually, in quotes, exiting COVID-19, when are they going to get it? Is it when their operations are, or is it when they have collapsed, or when they have exited the scene? So, but we also need to look at it, that government needs to help them whichever way they want to do that. But I guess government is also scared of giving them money, because we have examples of intervention in the past that government had given them money only for some of them to bolt away with taxpayers' money. And they've never, only very few of them are paying back. Some have gone into extinction. So how do you recover that money from them? It is gone down the drain. So if you look at aviation generally globally, aviation and tourism took the hardest hit with this COVID-19 pandemic. So it's going to be very difficult, not only in Nigeria, elsewhere. We've come across stories of airlines, you know, sacking big airlines that you never think that could even have issues, sacking as high as 10,000, 20,000 pilots, cutting their salaries by over 50%. Recently, the Virgin Atlantic even filed for Chapter 15 bankruptcy to tell you how bad the situation is all over the world, not only in Nigeria. So it has hit all economies. And I also read the news yesterday that Britain will go into recession. If Britain could go into recession, it means that a lot more countries will fall into recession.
Hold on, Mr. Chadari.
Nigeria is not an exception.
Hold on. I want to now speak, you know, now about passengers. Aside their airfare concerns, what safety measures do you think prospective passengers should take note of? And I'm asking this because when domestic flights resumed, I believe that there were a couple of reports that showed passengers still breaking one or two of these rules. And of course, including the seating arrangements in the aircraft. So what safety measures do you think prospective passengers must take note of?
Yeah, that is exactly what I said before, that we need to be very careful. We just don't need to throw our doors open and say, okay, we're excited that international flights are going to resume again. Some people are excited. Some people are not really excited because they are not sure of what we have done to show that we are really ready. But I believe they are working. The government is really, really working. What we should do, and is the function of everybody, not only the government, to ensure that we make their job easier for them, we make it also very easy for us not to to follow all the guidelines that are laid down. And if we see anybody breaking the rule or the rules, I think the authorities need to hand over the person to the appropriate authority, so that you don't use your own wahala or problem, like they will say, to affect innocent people. So we need to do more. It's not just the responsibility of government alone. It's the responsibility of everyone to keep safe, and it's the responsibility of everyone to ensure that all those guidelines are followed, which I believe before they begin to open the airspace, they will make it very, they will make it public for people to really know, because the things you don't know probably may not, you may not follow them, but the things you know, the tendency is there that we really want to follow those guidelines. But like they say, ignorance is not an excuse in law. but they must also make it very easy for people to see these guidelines. They must make it very easy for people to comprehend this guideline. Yes, you can bring it down and domesticate it with what we have in Nigeria and to make the job very easy for everybody to comply with.